Welcome back. And so last time I was talking about the pairing theorem. So what is the pairing theorem? Pairing theorem says that for an alternate system, the energy levels occur in pairs. So what we mean by that is, if we have an energy level at minus epsilon I, we also have an energy level at plus epsilon I. So the bonding and the antibonding energies are symmetrically located around the non-bonding line in the energy axis. So which means the following, that is, if I have the energy here, then I will have all the, I have a zero of energy here. So if there is one state there, there must be one state here. If there is one state here, there must be another state there, and another state here, and another state here. So this is minus epsilon 1 plus epsilon 1 minus epsilon 2 plus epsilon 2, etc., etc., minus epsilon n plus epsilon n. So they always occur in pairs. Okay, so supposing I go to an infinite polymer, we will have all these anti-bonding and bonding levels become conduction bands and valence bands respectively, so that I will have a conduction band and a valence band. The valence band is completely filled, conduction band is empty, and this is the zero of energy located symmetrically around the zero, and the widths of the both the bands are exactly identical, and so on and so forth. So you can also say something more about the eigenstates itself. The eigenstates of the eigenstate of the epsilon k level is psi of k equal to C k phi k star plus C k phi k 0. So let me introduce what I actually mean by this. So actually there are large number of starred orbitals. So you have, for every starred orbital there is a coefficient. You can separate your eigenstates I k into some over starred orbitals and some over unstarred orbitals. And the coefficients of the sum over starred orbitals is C k star, k going to from 1 to n by 2, and similarly phi k 0, k goes from 1 to n by 2, and it is C k 0 phi k 0. Then this is of the state minus epsilon k. Then psi k, psi of minus k state will be C k star phi k star minus C k 0 phi k 0. So this is of the plus epsilon k state. So the two are related. So if you know the coefficients of one, you know the coefficients of the other. So all these things is because the Hamiltonian matrix is tridiagonal and symmetric about the diagonal. This was first recognized by Coulson and Rushbrook. So this pairing theorem is credited to Coulson and Rushbrook. Now let us see what happens when you have an odd number of so all that the above description is for n even. So we have n by 2 occupied orbitals which are bonding molecular orbitals, and n by 2 unoccupied molecular orbitals which are non this anti-bonding molecular orbitals. So what happens when n is odd? Again, the pairing theorem should be valid. And so what happens is that the odd state is unpaired, there is no pairing state for that, and hence should be at energy 0 or should be a non-bonding orbital. So what we have in the case of n odd is that if this is the energy axis, then if this is 0, then I have a state here and all the other states are below and above and they are all paired. So there is a pairing of these states and the pairing of these states. So when we have the infinite limit or the polymer limit, what we will have is I have a conduction band and then a state in the middle, and then I have a valence band. So this is called the mid-gap state. The mid-gap state is purely a consequence of the pairing theorem. And now we have two situations, one when n is even and n is odd. So these in the polymer limit we can write them as we can write them as follows. This is n even and this is n odd. So this is the valence band, conduction band, valence band, conduction band, and this is the mid-gap state. There is one more thing that the theorem, which is alternancy symmetry theorem, says. When a system has alternancy symmetry, the lowest energy excitation is dipolar load, which means that the optical absorption edge that you will find at the lower energy site corresponds to the gap between the lowest occupied molecular orbital and the highest unoccupied molecular orbital. And of course in this we will have one electron also, because we have an odd number of sites. So what it means is that in this case you have an absorption which is at Eg, okay? Whereas in this case you have an absorption from here to here which is Eg by 2, or from here to here which is also Eg by 2. So it means that when you have solitons, I'm jumping and saying solitons, so when we have an odd number of sides or odd number of carbon atoms in a polymer, in polyacetylene specifically, we should have a mid-gap absorption. This is very interesting because it means that if you take a polymer of polyacetylene with 1000 carbon atoms and then with 1001 carbon atoms, the spectra are completely different. In one case you will have a spectra at Eg by 2, starts at Eg by 2, and in the other case it starts from Eg. So this is what alternance symmetry theorem says, and we will also see how does one get odd number of carbon atoms in a chain. Well, polyacetylene is prepared from what is called a cis trans polyacetylene. This is the cis trans polyacetylene, and to get all trans polyacetylene you have to make the isomerization from the ends. So if you start isomerizing from the ends using a Ziegler-Natta catalysis, what you will get is the following. You will start getting this polymer, which is the all trans polymer, which is the one that we are interested in. Now, if the number of carbon atoms is even, this is what happens. If the number of carbon atoms is odd, then what happens is the following. That is, it will start this way from this end, and probably from this end it will start this way. So you will end up with a kink. Let me make it a little neater. So here you have double bonds on the left, and here you have double bonds on right. And in the middle there is a crossover. So this crossover region is known as a solitonic region because it is a boundary. So it is like a solitary wave. So what is happening is, supposing I were to plot something like the difference between bond order on the left minus bond order on the right, and then I have the middle here, left and right I have the same bond orders. So here bond order on the left is higher, so it will be going like this, switch. So this is the solitonic signature. It can be represented by a tan hyperbolic function. And so it's and solitons are usually represented by tan hyperbolic functions. I will not go into the details, like, you know, nonlinear differential equations that give you this, but nonetheless this is what happens in the case of a soliton. So whenever we have a soliton, we have a mid-gap state. And in fact, you can think of solitons as elementary excitations. Like you can say that a soliton-antisoliton pair is an excitation. Gives excitations in a even carbon chain. So that way you can think of solitons as elementary excitations. In the polyacetylene case, if you are dealing with non-interacting Hamiltonians, that is only the Huckel model. And this was very well described by Su, Schieffer and Heger. In the model known as the SSH model. And this was 1979. But of course, the kink was known. Kink and properties of kink, they were called kink instead of solitons by chemists. Kink. Now the new nomenclature is soliton after the Su, Schieffer, Heger model. They were known as early as 1962 by Popel and Wamsley. And it was also known that the polyacetylene chain will have alternately double and single bonds from the work of Piles, because it is a Piles unstable system. And actual algebra was worked out by Salem and Longett-Higgins sometime in 1950s, 57 or 58, and Piles' theorem was somewhere around 51 or 52. It was in his book, The Quantum Theory of Solids. The paper was not published by Piles, but he just alluded to this Piles instability in his book on quantum theory of solids. Well, let us see what are the properties of these solitonic state is. So, what it says is that the wave function of the solitonic state will be sigma over k equal to 1 to n ck phi k, and ck is equal to 0 at odd number, at even number sites, let us say. And non-zero at odd number sites. So, on one sublattice, the wave functions, the contribution of the atomic wave function to the solitonic state is zero, and at the other sublattice, they will contribute. So, what it means is also the following, that is, the spin density, the spin density can actually be measured using an electron spin resonance experiment. And what this predicts is spin density is always positive or zero. This is completely against the many electron picture which says that there is some kind of an anti-ferromagnetic correlation because of electron-electron repulsions. And so you must have a positive spin density at one site and negative spin density at the neighboring sites. So, but that is not what you will see in the case of non-interacting pictures. And also, if you look at the solitons, you have one more property, that is, I can dope the solitons. So, I have solitons which can be doped. They are all at the mid-gap state. So when you dope it, then if it is neutral soliton, you have no doping, so you have one unpaired electron there. And if it is negatively charged soliton, you have two electrons there, and a positively charged soliton, has no electrons in the mid-gap state. And it is possible to dope polyacetylene, okay, that way. So what it implies is also that there is a spin charge separation in the soliton. That is, whenever a soliton is charged, it has no spin. Whenever a soliton is spin, then it is not charged. So there is a spin charge separation, and these are all very nice predictions of the non-interacting theory. Well, let us see what happens when we have interacting theories. When we have interacting theories, then the electron hole symmetry subdivides the full space, that is full space of all configurations, of all electron configurations, of a half filled system. Into two subspaces. So in these, one subspace contains covalent states and another subspace, the second subspace, does not contain covalent states. So, what do we mean by covalent states? Covalent states are many body states, that is, you can write down Slater determinants, many body states having only one electron per atomic orbital, per site orbital or atomic orbital. So all of them are zero. So when you have only these configurations, so this is covalent. Anything that has a C0, C plus, C minus, etcetera, these are all ionic. Okay? And the covalent space has both covalent and ionic diagrams. And ionic states, but ionic space has only ionic states. So you will not have a configuration which corresponds to C0, C0, C0 in that. So now we also know that the total spin, so we can say that covalent space, we can call it as a plus space or covalent space, and ionic states we can call as minus or ionic states. The Hamiltonian will also conserve total spin, because these are all non-relativistic Hamiltonians. The Hamiltonian conserves total spin. Hence, the states can be labeled by multiplicity. Spin multiplicity which is 2s plus 1. So, a singlet state has a superscript one, a triplet superscript 3, etc., etc. And because it is a polymer, because it is a linear polymer, in its ideal situation, we can assume an inversion symmetry. That is, if you invert the polymer by the middle carbon atom, then it does not look any different, and so that is the reason why it has an inversion symmetry. So, this inversion symmetry classifies the states as A or B depending upon whether the state has inversion symmetry or not. Now, so we have actually the identity, the inversion symmetry, the electron hole symmetry, and which is and spin symmetry. So, every state can be labeled as follows. A many body state can be labeled by the number of that kind of state. It can be 1, 2 or 3, and whether it is A or B, whether it is a singlet or a triplet, which is given as a superscript, and whether it is covalent or ionic. You can either put a superscript on the right as minus or plus. So, basically what you really have are A covalent, B covalent, A ionic, B ionic, and you can have singlet or triplet, etc., etc. And the ordinal number of the sides. A state. So, these together define every one of the many body states. So, these labels uniquely identify the many body state. Now, we know that if we have covalent states, so covalent states of low lying at least, have lower energy than low-lying ionic states. This is because of electron correlations. And usually, low-lying triplet is covalent, similar to the ground state, and has an energy less than ionic singlet or triplet, or the lowest excited state in the singlet space, lowest excited covalent triplet. Usually this is the case for intermediate correlations. And all these things we are talking about is, this is all in the intermediate correlation regime. So what do you mean by intermediate correlation strength? So the correlation strength is always compared to the bandwidth, because bandwidth tells you how strong the transfer energy is and so forth. So U done by W characterizes the strength of electron correlations. In one dimension particularly, in one dimension, W is small, equal to 4T. That is because, you know, when the electron is moving around, there is only one direction in which it can move. There is only one axis along which it can move. Either it can move to the right or it can move to the left. So two electrons cannot escape each other easily, because of which the correlation effects are much stronger in one dimension. But you go to the two-dimensional case, then the two electrons can avoid each other more easily than in the one dimension, because one that is coming from the left and the one that is coming from the right can suddenly switch, and one can go on top and the other can go below, and they can avoid, because it is a two-dimensional case. In a three-dimensional case, of course, there is even more possibility of avoiding two electrons. So the correlation effects are strongest in one dimension and intermediate in two dimensions, and not very large in three dimensions. So we are considering the one-dimensional case, where the strength of correlations is pretty large, because the bandwidth is only 4T. So U equal to 4T, U approximately equal to 4T is the intermediate correlation regime. In the case of PPP models, there is no strict correspondence between the Hubbard U and the correlation energy as such, because if you only look at nearest neighbor interactions, then you see that the real correlation energy is U minus V. So this can be equal to U effective. So one compares U effective divided by 4T for PPP models, but still we are only taking the nearest neighbor electron-electron repulsion or attraction, and not going beyond the nearest neighbor. And it is also known that the U effective Hubbard model does not have the same excitation gaps as the UV model or the PPP model. So U effective, a single parameter like U effective, cannot replicate a Pariser par Popple model. For example, if you have only U effective, you will never have exciton, bound excitons. You require a separately U and V. Okay, so I will stop here in this lecture, and we will continue again from here in the next lecture. Thank you very much.